In our opening session one, we talked about the impact of trauma. And we know that children are wounded in the context of interpersonal relationships, and they're only going to heal in the context of interpersonal relationships. And you can play an incredibly important role in the lives of your children, whether you are a parent, a teacher, a coach. You can make a difference, and you could be a middle circle person in your child's life.
We were teaching these principles in the country of Armenia. Now, Armenia is a country that's been through many, many traumas. Earthquakes, the Soviet Union, and then the Nazis before that, and just suffering of all kinds. We were training these things, probably 30 or 40 people in the training. And in the training was a pastor named Pastor Raphael. And he asked if he could share a story about what we were talking about. And I said, of course, would love to hear it. He had suffered much with his people through all of the times that he'd been through with them, in his 60s perhaps. Anyway, he came up and shared a story. He said, there was in this little village where we were at that time, a boy that was so wild. Nobody could tame him. They beat him, they threatened him, they threw him in jail. All kinds of things were done to get this boy to behave himself. And so Pastor Raphael was called. He said, yes, bring the boy to me. And the day was assigned that they would bring this boy to Pastor's office. And Pastor did four things. The first thing he did was, when they brought the boy in, Pastor Raphael got out from behind his desk. In other words, he removed any barriers to relationship. In all of my counseling practice, I never sit behind a desk. I always sit in a chair in front of them. So Pastor Raphael removed the desk as a division. Number two, he looked him in the eye. And that story of looking him in the eye was, I see you. I see you. Then Pastor Raphael did a third thing. He smiled at him. And that was a message sent to this boy that I approve of you. You get the message here? Nonverbals are powerful, powerful tools of healing, of relationship. And the fourth thing that he did was he nodded, kind of like that, as if to say, you're welcome in my world. And that so confused and confounded this boy's expectation that his heart was softened, and he developed a relationship with Pastor Raphael that was a healing journey. We just talked to Pastor Raphael, what, 6 months ago?
6 months ago. Mm-hmm.
And asked about the boy in the story, and he's doing well. But it all started by one man being a middle circle to tap into that boy's need with the resources he needed.
David, what is a middle circle person?
It's a great question. As you can see in the bottom circle, this is a circle representing a child or a boy or a girl or anybody who's been through trauma. He's all scrambled. He's been abused and he's been neglected. And this has caused all kinds of problems within him, and it's showing up in his behavior. By the way, there's two kinds of wounds. One wound is the bad things that happened to us. The second kind of wound is the good things that should have happened do not. Abuse and neglect, both terribly, terribly problematic and wounding. So here's a person, we're talking about a child now, who has been wounded deeply and profoundly. And at the top, we see another circle, and this is what this child needs to heal. This is what I call the resource circle. And these are the things that he or she or they need to heal from the impact of trauma that they've experienced. But unless there is a connecting between the resource circle and the needed one circle, there's nothing is happening. So there needs to be a middle circle that is competent in the resources and connects with the child. And those resources then flow from the top circle down through the middle circle into the child. No healing can happen. Without the middle circle. It's absolutely essential. And this is a great biblical truth. We, all of us, were in the bottom circle. We were confused, chaos, lost, all that sort of thing. God, our Father, had resources. He had ways to help us. But how did he do that? He sent his Son to bring the resources and connect with us, and we all can experience healing. It's a great principle. When I sit down with a mostly adult person who's been through trauma, now they're adults and they're still struggling terribly with all kinds of negative things going on. When I talk to them, one of the questions I ask them, was there ever anybody in your life as a child or somewhere along the way that you look back on and he or she was a middle circle, a person that was that you could relate to, that was you felt safe with, that helped you overcome whatever you're facing? And as they think about it, almost every one of them will come up with, yeah, my grandmother or my coach or our teacher, somebody. So that's why it is so important that we do what we do, because we might be that person that they point back to later on in their life.
And when I have the opportunity to speak with foster and adoptive parents at conferences or in workshops, I share this with them and say, you are an incredible middle circle person. Teachers, coaches, parents, pastors can fulfill that role. But there are challenges within that. And we're going to talk just a minute about what are the characteristics of a middle circle person. The first characteristic is that they understand the need for a child's attachment and orientation. And what we mean by that, they understand the need to connect with a child and be that role model on how to help that child grow and develop. A middle circle person understands that heavy lifting and love are required. David shares a term that I love. Would you share that term?
In Galatians 6:2, it talks about fulfilling the law of Christ. And those of us who work with kids and people who are broken and wounded and hurting and dying, we are fulfilling the law of Christ. But what is the law of Christ? Well, I define it this way. The law of Christ is when I voluntarily suffer something, time, money, whatever. I voluntarily suffer the loss of something for the redemptive for a redemptive purpose in the life of another. And that's the only way I can explain why you do what you do. You are fulfilling the law of Christ by caring for kids, by voluntarily suffering something to help them out.
I will never forget the time I was doing a workshop for foster and adoptive parents, and a woman walked in pushing a baby buggy, and it was very obvious this youngster had severe medical issues. He had a feeding tube and all sorts of other gadgets around them. And the mother simply looked at me, that actually was adoptive mother, and she said, shaken baby. This was a shaken baby. And I asked her the next question, when was the last time you had a full night's sleep? And she said, the night before he moved in. That's voluntary redemptive suffering. And she was staying right with it. Well, there's some other characteristics of middle circle person. Another one is that they understand the needs to have and maintain boundaries. We can get sucked into the needs of others so easily, so it's important that we maintain boundaries.
And boundaries are important not just for the middle circle, but boundaries are a great teaching thing for the kids who come from chaos. They don't know anything about boundaries. But when you maintain boundaries, that teaches them to have and maintain them as well.
Very, very important.
Yeah.
And the last characteristic, a middle circle person understands the need to keep showing up. I love the story of Bishop Aaron Blake. Many of you probably know of Bishop Blake. Bishop Blake, at one point in his life, was a counselor in a high school. And one afternoon, a young man came in and said, Bishop Blake, I'm in trouble. Can I move in your house? And he said, well, I need to call my wife. So he called his wife, Mary, and he found out this youngster was in foster care. And Mary said, yes, they had five older adult children who were out of the house. This young man was on the school football team. Well, about a week or two later, two more boys said, came in his office, Mr. Blake, I'm in trouble. I need to move. Can I move in your house? And so, to make a long story short, over a very short period of time, he had six teenage boys from the football team who were in foster care moving in his house. Well, as time went on, of course, they had all of their issues. But one night, two of the boys were playing with candles, and they caught the house on fire, and it literally burnt to the ground. Now, when these boys moved in, Bishop Blake said to every one of them, you are engrafted in our family. There's nothing you can do to have us move you from our home. Well, Bishop Blake had met, and what he said, a near breaking point. And he and his wife, Mary, were watching the house burn to the ground. And he said to his wife, I don't think I can do this anymore. What do you want to do, Mary? And Mary simply said, go to Walmart. He said, what do you mean, go to Walmart? That's what families do when their house burns to the ground. They go get clothes for the next day. And it was just kind of a wake-up call to remind him that these boys were engrafted. Those boys expected to be moved, but the Blake family kept showing up for them.
One of the most important things about what we teach about trauma-informed care and all that is that it's biblically based. It is consistent with what we believe the Bible teaches about human relationships and healing. Jesus is absolutely the prime example of a middle circle. And he came from eternity, brought resources. The Father provided for him, for us. He brought them to us. And now you and I and all of us who are believers live in that reality. Jesus Christ is our middle circle.